Hi everyone, welcome to our talk, Reverse Engineering Archaeology, about the behind the scenes of the archaeology that we had to do during the Ripple 20 research. Now, what we're let's tell you a little bit about us before we start. So JSOF is a software security consultancy. We focus on security research of IoT devices. My name is Shlomi Oberman. I'm a co-founder of the company. We'll be speaking with me today, Moshe Kol, who found the Ripple 20 vulnerabilities and did reverse engineering for most of the devices that we'll be talking about today and most of the reverse engineering. And Ariel Schön, also a security researcher at JSOF, that was involved in the exploitation on one of the devices that we'll be talking about today and reverse engineering of that device. We'll give you a short intro about Ripple 20 for those of you that haven't heard about it, but that's not the main topic of the talk. And then we'll talk about what needed to be done during the research, how we did the research for Ripple 20, and why it was so complex, why we had to reverse engineer so many different devices. We'll then do a wrap up and some conclusions and takeaways from the different binaries that we reverse engineered. So Ripple 20 is a series of 19 zero-day vulnerabilities that JSOF reported in a TCP IP stack, a very common TCP IP stack that is proprietary. And the vulnerabilities were amplified by the supply chain, meaning because it was sold to vendors who then sold it forward and then sold it forward, it reached all kinds of devices in all kinds of different verticals. We estimate hundreds of millions of devices were affected in all different types of devices. Of these vulnerabilities, 4 CVEs are critical remote code execution vulnerabilities, and the rest have varying degrees of severity. And the vendors affected really range from home devices like HP printers to UPS devices that we'll talk about, and industrial devices, networking devices, medical. So pretty much any type of device. The different devices got the Treck stack over time. So they implemented or integrated the Treck stack over the years. And they also got the stack in different ways. So some were firsthand users, they bought the stack from Treck, but some use an operating system, for example, that incorporates the TCP IP stack. In order to do the research, we took 7 different devices. And for some of the devices, we took multiple versions. During the talk, you'll see why we had to do all of this and what was involved. And every device had a different configuration of Treck. So different timeline, they incorporated Treck, the TCP IP stack, at a different time in history, and a different compilation, different features. Some of the vendors didn't use all of the TCP IP features, so we couldn't research the features on that vendor. And also we had different information. For example, we were able to take debug symbols from one device and then use that to reverse engineer a different device. The research took approximately 9 months all in all, and involved some pretty strange architectures. You'll see some of those. I don't want to give you a spoiler. The research itself about Ripple 20, the results are well published, so we're not going to be talking about them so much. But we released 2 white papers about 2 of the CVEs. And also gave a DEF CON talk, so you can see the background later if you're interested or if you haven't already. So let's talk about the challenge that we faced when we started reverse engineering. So we had this library, Treck TCP IP, which is basically one code base, but it has many instances, many different versions that use different features, that compile differently, running different architectures, as we said, different timeline, et cetera. When we started the reverse engineering, when we started the process, we had no idea how varied and complex, how many different versions of Treck there are. And we had no idea that we were going to find different versions of the same vulnerability appearing completely differently in different devices. one of the vendors that we reported to eventually told us in a moment of honesty that they also reverse engineer the code because there are more preprocessor if defines in the code than actual code, and it's easier for them to read the specific version that they use in the binaries. So extremely configurable. So we had to take different devices, multiple data points, combine the information, and try to extract the history of what happened and the vulnerabilities. As you'll see, we often made mistakes. We got it wrong, and we only found out how wrong we were at the end when we reported the vulnerabilities. Now there's a lot of years of history to this project. We didn't reverse engineer devices that old, but the library itself dates to before the year 2000. And you know, throughout the project, we sort of realized that we're dealing with this strange supply chain issue and multiple device, multiple history issue, and we started calling it an archeology project. Some of the challenge was just getting the firmwares themselves, getting the devices, etc. Now I'll transfer the mic to Moshe Kol, who will be talking about how we started the research. This is not the actual very beginning of the research, because there was a pre-beginning of understanding that there is something called Treck TCP IP library, and deciding that it's a good target to research. But immediately after that, how do you perform this research? So please, Moshe.
Thanks, Shlomi. So for doing the research, we needed to obtain binaries for Treck. And the natural thing to do is to browse to Treck websites. And there was a downloads page with two demos. First demo was a Freescale microcontroller demo, and the other one was a Windows port of the TCP/IP stack. So we started looking at the Freescale demo, and we extracted the zip file and found a few helpful header files and a static library called the treck-lib.a, which has roughly 200 object files, and you can see some of the names of protocols that we were interested in research them. The architecture of this specific microcontroller, the processor is a Motorola 68030, big endian, and the object files contains function names. So function names are really helpful when doing reverse engineering, because they let you understand a little bit about the internals of the TCP/IP stack. And the function themselves, in the object file themselves, there was a problem, because a non-local function calls, that is function calls that don't live in the same object files, are missing from the object files. And you can see here in the picture, you have a call to a function with four bytes of just null bytes. So this gave us a hard time reverse engineering the stacks, but we can extract some of the names from the relocation table. So we could obtain some information about the function calls from the relocation table, but this is not very handy, not very convenient. So in summary, this was a useful data point to build the function call graph and understand a little bit about the Treck internals, because we have function names, but this cannot be debugged easily, so we turn to the Windows port of the Treck stack. So the Windows port feature useful features of the stack, such as IPv4, IPv6, a DHCP client, etc., etc. And we can debug this binary, this Windows binary. So this was helpful. If we found a vulnerability, we can like test it. But a drawback of this demo is that there is no debug symbol, so there is no function names, such as the Freescale binary. It has some log message function with some helpful debug strings, like enter and the name of the function that it enters. But this applies mostly to IPv6 functions and not to IPv4 functions. So the most of the stack, most of the function names of the stack, we were not able to get using these debug strings. So we needed something else to find the code base. So what we ended up doing is using the ether type field of the Ethernet packet to look at the function that processing the Ethernet frames. So inside the Ethernet frame format, there is a two octet field called ether type. And this ether type field specifies what is the type of the payload that the Ethernet frame is carrying. So for IPv4, the constant is hex 800, and for IPv6, the constant is pretty unique, is 86DD. So we simply search for these constants in the binary and intersect all of the functions that these three constants appear in. And that way we were able to find the function that processing the Ethernet packet. It is called TF ether received, as we later came to realization. So using and from this function, the ether receives, we were able to branch to other code base in the stack, to the function that handles IPv4 packets, the function that handles ARP and IPv6. And we were starting reverse engineering large parts of this demo, large parts of the network stack, and we were able to find some vulnerabilities. And we wanted to test if other devices are affected. The drawback of using the demo is that the version of the Treck stack is relatively old. So yeah, this was a challenge in the archaeology. So what we ended up doing is searching online for Treck TCP IP, and we saw that some member of the Digi community mentioned that Digi Connect devices shipped with Treck TCP IP. So what we ended up doing is bought some device that is known to use this TCP IP stack. And the device we bought was a Digi Connect device. It looks like an Ethernet connector, but is actually full system on module. It comes with two flavors. It's either running embedded Linux or running a proprietary Digi operating system called the NetOS. So the network stack of Net plus OS, I think above version 7 is Treck TCP IP. And we bought the old development kit because we wanted to debug if we find a vulnerability, and we found some vulnerabilities in the demo. So we wanted to debug and develop an exploit for it. So we ended up buying the development kit. So the Digi Connect device runs on ARM9 core. It's, we can debug it using a JTAG interface, and it comes with an Eclipse-based IDE to write software, deploy software on it. So that way we compiled a simple basic example and examined the resulting L file, and the L file comes loaded with debug symbols. So it's it was nice to have this debug symbols for reverse engineering, because we can learn about more about the internals of tracks and verifying some assumptions we made in during the reverse engineering of the demo, the Windows demo. And what we've done with this device is to develop an exploit for a previously found vulnerability that we found in the demo. It was a vulnerability that involves fragmented data and over an IP and IP tunnel with the UDP as a transport layer. So we exploited this vulnerability on this device. And the disadvantage of using this data point is that it contains relatively old Treck version, 4.7, as far as we know. So we wanted to know if the vulnerability that we have is 0 day or not. So we are looking for more new versions of the stack. And this leads us to look into Intel ME, Intel Management Engine. We found that Treck powers the AMT module inside the Intel Management Engine. And what we thought is that since Intel is a security aware company, they must have a updated Treck version. So if we look at the Intel binary, presumably, if the vulnerability still exists there, then it must exist in Treck upstream. So by looking at the binary, we saw that Intel has some defensive programming. They were verifying some length fields of core structures of the network stack. And the specific vulnerability that we found was fixed due to this sanity checks. So we thought we had the 1 days that still existed in the wild. And this sanity checks, maybe they are fixes, maybe they are if def that is global to the whole library. But maybe Intel is just paranoid, so we didn't know at this stage. But we thought we had 1 day at this point. So during the research period, Intel releases an advisory, a security advisory, and we saw their vulnerability description that resembles the component that it mentions resembles Treck. So we can read the description. It says insufficient input validation is in a subsystem of Intel AMT before version may allow unauthenticated user, user that it can send network packets, to potentially enable denial of services or information disclosure via adjacent access, meaning reside specifically on the link or on the same subnets, meaning packets that are not routable. So we wanted to patch the AMT versions in order to find this vulnerability. So we obtained two ME firmware versions online. So the ME versions we used was 12.0.32, and the newer version was 12.0.55. And we use the ME analyzer tool to unpack the firmware and extract the AMT module. And as Apache diffing tool, we use the bin diff. And the diff was large, relatively large, and it's relatively manual inspection. Like 300 functions were different. And we wanted to focus on Treck related code only. We didn't care about other track in other code in AMT that was changed. So we needed to devise a way to focus, first find the track code and then focus specifically on track library functions. So to find the track code, we used the function called TFUse Ethernet and we signed it. It has relatively regular structure, it initializes a struct, a linked layer struct with the function pointers, and our known function that processes Ethernet packets is assigned to this struct, this function pointer, this TF Ether receive. And it also features two strings called two references for the same string. The string is called ETH-DAX, which is the name of the Ethernet standard. And what we ended up doing is like assigning this function structure using a regular expression that, and you can see here that they assigned various function pointers to the same structure. So it is relatively easy to assign this pattern using a regular expression because the offset changes. So that's what we ended up doing. And we found this function in the two AMT binaries that we had. And using the string reference, we were able to find the image base address. So we can correct it in our ARI tool. And we developed a Gitter script to mark trick related to it. We talk about how we did it in a second. And then extracted the symbols from Gidra to IDA for diffing, because BINDIFF uses IDB, IDA IDBs. So our algorithm for marking the track related code was basically to traverse the call graph from known track libraries as entry points. So here you can see TF Ether receive, the function that processes Ethernet frames. In the call graph, it calls various other functions of track, and they call various other functions of track, and also library functions. So we used function pointers in TFU's Ethernet as our entry points. And luckily for us, library functions like memcopy or stuff like this resigned in separate modules of the management engine, and thus were not resolved by our reverse engineering tools. So they are not considered as functions for this algorithm. So we were traversing the call graph, and in order to gain more coverage, we considered parents of functions that have many cross references. So for example, the function tflock is called from many functions throughout the network stack. So we speculated that if we took a function that has many cross references, maybe it's some function like TF lock, and then we were able to find more entry points, presumably of track. And this approach works very well. We were able to extract to find some fixed bug, and the fixed bugs was found in the DCP v6 client, and the bug resides in during the option 24 processing. It's this option called domain search list, the function called the tf6 DCP save reply info, and the functions where the vulnerability resides calculates a total label length. So it accepts a single argument called buff and computes the total label length. So here you can see that they simply traverse the buffer until they reach a null byte. And this causes a readout of bound vulnerability. And this matches the descriptions of the CVE we saw earlier in the Intel advisory. So it matches the adjacent access because this is DTP and these packets are not routable. And this is also can cause an info leak or denial of service. So we were looking at the fix and how Treck fixes this vulnerability. And now you can see that they added the check in the loop to see what if the total length variable is less than or equal to 192. So, but this doesn't fixes the out of bound access. So you can still put a name in a packet, in a short packet, and during this processing, you can reach out of bound memory. So still there is vulnerability, and we reported this issue to Treck, got this CVE number. So the main takeaway from looking at the Intel binary is that some of the vulnerabilities we found fixed only in Intel, and other vendors were affected. Also, Intel has export mitigation, so they were quite unique vendor in that regard. So Digi held old code and Intel had new code, but Intel don't have all of the code. So for example, they didn't have a DNS client code because they use something else. They implement their own DNS client. And so until disclosure, we thought that some bugs were one days and Intel was the most updated. But during the disclosure, Treck informed us that these were actually a 0 days. So the story behind this AMT binary is complicated. It's not very clear. And we come to a realization during the research that there are a few types of Treck supply chain vulnerabilities. Some vulnerabilities that are true 0 days, that is affect Treck upstream code. 0 days that were fixed only in Intel code, to our knowledge, only in AMT code. And end days, like 1 days, etc., that exist in the wild and fixed upstream. So this vulnerability were never publicly reported, as far as we know. And we also don't know if these vulnerabilities was considered the security fixes or just feature updates as Treck evolves. So if you're a vendor and you use Treck and you have support package, then you mean then it means you get updates, whether it's feature updates or security updates. And if you have no support, then it means you get no security. And we think this should be distinct. Like security updates should be distinct from feature updates. In the research, we examined another binary. This one was an HP printer. We found that some HP printers run Treck during using a Google search. And we wanted to check if HP printers are affected by the vulnerabilities. So first we need to obtain the firmware and unpack it. So we obtained an RFU file. It stands for remote firmware update file from HP's public FTP server. And to unpack the firmware, it took quite a lot of effort. There were bizarre file formats, so multiple stages of compression and different file formats. Like you have the first layer, you have PGL and PCL layer, and then you have an S record layer, which is in ASCII, that parses a binary S record layer. And then after all of that, you have this flash out of band data that you need to remove. Then you need to locate the firmware section table, and the firmwares themselves were compressed also with a different compression scheme. So we need to decompress those sections also. So this process was quite involved, and the whole process is described in our blog. And after we unpacked the firmware, we were able to find the vulnerability variant of the fragmented vulnerability. So if we send our POC packets to the printer crashes. And apparently this is due to an if def that disallows fragmented data over an IP tunnel. And if you send those packets, then TF kernel error, the function TF kernel error is run. And in HP, this function simply stops the thread and stop crashing the printer. So simply panics. So this was the first vulnerability variant that we found. And later variants were found later in the research. So now I'll hand over the mic to Ariel Schön. He'll talk about the another binary, the APC UPS binary.
Hello. So my name is Ariel. I'm also a security researcher at JSOF, and I research mainly the firmware of the APC UPS. So as you've seen, Moshe already did a lot of research leading up to this. So we had some good knowledge of Treck and also had lots of firmware images to compare stuff. So let's go into this. So getting the firmware was relatively straightforward. We can download firmware updates from the APC website. And the format is a lot simpler than what Moshe just described about HP. So the images are not encrypted or compressed in any way. And it's relatively easy to understand what are the different fields. You can clearly see a base address as in here, a file size, and some CRCs to make sure everything is valid, and lots of other fields that are less interesting to us. So first thing, when we want to reverse this, we need to understand what is the architecture, what is the machine this code is supposed to run on. So we load it into Ghidra, and we can see this is Intel opcodes, and choosing a 16-bit Intel sort of works, but not exactly. Some stuff seem a bit off. Mainly far calls and references to strings and stuff like that. They're not resolved at all, and they seem very wrong. So we knew something isn't quite right, so we had to dig deeper. The memory addressing, as I said, is a bit off. It can be protected mode because there are lots of segments, as you can see in the far call destinations, and we couldn't find any GDT. And it can be real mode because the simple shifting the segment by 4 bits doesn't resolve the problems. So we opened every manual we can find looking for maybe this is a very old processor, maybe we don't know. We checked unreal mode, which is, if you don't know, it's an obscure operating mode for Intel processors in which you load large segment registers and operate in real mode to access high memory, but that didn't work either. So we looked for some other clue, and you can see a pattern here. If you can see the string addresses, the linear addresses, the least significant byte is clearly visible in some push instructions. So we saw this pattern over and over again. The string isn't resolved correctly, but we can find a push instruction in which the least significant byte corresponds to a string we expect to find. So just using some basic arithmetic, binary arithmetic, we can see that if we shift the segment register by 8 bits instead of 4 bits, everything works perfectly. And so we saw this works for far calls, this works for strings, this works for everything we had to see. But this is indeed weird. We couldn't find anything that explains what this phenomena is. So leaving the phenomena aside, we managed to understand what happened so we can actually reverse. But no processor module in Ghidra or IDA natively supports this weird architecture. We tried to recompile Ghidra's x86 processor module with partial success. Functions were resolved, but strings were not. We tried to specify granularity on Vadare, which works a bit better, but still no luck. And finally, we found someone on the OpenRCE forum that experienced the same problem. And it also told us what may be the processor we are looking at. It's a Turbo 186, an old processor from the era in which Intel still used to sell their processors as an intellectual property. And we saw the solution that Igor Skosinski posted on this forum, and we implemented it ourselves. So thanks to Igor. So we just wrote an IDA Python script to create lots of segment selectors corresponding to the real segments. So we shift the selector ourselves by 4 bits, and then IDA will shift it by 4 bits again, giving us the shift by 8 effect. So now everything was parsed correctly. So we have far calls and strings and switch statements, and we can actually reverse, sadly without a decompiler, since 16-bit decompilation is not supported on IDA. Another weird thing that we had to solve is that even after we fixed the segments, we saw lots of far calls pointing to non-mapped regions. Comparing this with the Digi Connect firmware Moshe talked about earlier, we realized that these are far calls to heap functions such as malloc, free. And just to put this in context, we reversed this APC network card to exploit a heap overflow vulnerability. So getting to the heap code was of absolute necessity. So we saw that the AOS binary has debug strings containing the function names for malloc and free and other heap utility functions. But these strings had no references. Luckily, as we showed earlier, because of the 8-bit segment shift, we knew that pushing strings on the stacks, we will see a push instruction with a least significant byte corresponding to the string linear address. So we could search for these instructions, and we did find undefined push instructions and defined and remapped them, and everything worked properly. So this device had a newer Treck version, and we also found a new vulnerability in it reported under the said CVE, a bad RD-length vulnerability, which resulted because of a bad fix for a previous vulnerability that we did find. This didn't exist in AMT because they just don't use this feature. A bonus binary is the General Electric MDS, communication device for utilities. We didn't use it much. We just use ngrams and Google search or CPU rec to find the architecture. It runs on a Blackton processor. It does use Treck, but we had lots of firmwares already, so we didn't need to use it. So it didn't teach us anything. So I'll call back Shlomi for the wrap up.
Thank you, Ariel and Moshe. We're getting close to the end of the talk, so we'll just do a quick wrap up of everything we talked about and some stuff that we learned along the way, some stuff that we think we learned along the way. One of the main takeaways is that supply chain is very complicated, and it's more complicated than we thought. We didn't expect to see vulnerability variants. We didn't expect to see if there's changing vulnerabilities. We didn't expect to see vendors. This is maybe a late reply to the question asked in the beginning. We didn't expect to see vendors changing the code for security reasons, and then these patches just exist in one device. Another takeaway is that obscurity, the fact that you use a stack, a TCP/IP stack that is not well known and is not open source, and the fact that you embed your code under several layers of compression and obfuscation and different strange file formats doesn't help your security that much. For example, we were able to reverse engineer the HP firmware, just like we were able to reverse engineer the APC firmware, despite completely different structures. The APC was almost a plain text binary, and the HP firmware was many layers of encoding and compression. This is mostly correct because, for example, we didn't do any firmwares from automotive or aviation industry because they're very hard to get and very hard to decompress. Another takeaway is for the manufacturers that they should definitely patch everything that comes from upstream. The higher or the lower, the deeper they are in the supply chain, the more important it is. And many of the vendors we contacted didn't know they had Treck. So not only patch your supply chain upstream, but know your supply chain upstream. the whole research got us thinking about what should be an SLA for patch management in complex supply chain issues. One of the interesting questions, of course, is proprietary versus open source, and we actually have a similar supply chain open source disclosure coming up, so it will be interesting to compare. And another interesting question is, what happens when you don't get support? Should product support be different from security support? For example, for product support, you pay every year. We imagine it's expensive, we don't know. But maybe security support should come for a longer time frame. It shouldn't be free, of course, but maybe it should be a separate process. And it should definitely be part of your agreement with software suppliers. If you buy a piece of software, make sure you get security patches for the life of the product. Something else, and this is maybe the most interesting takeaway, at least for me, is that when you have one library in so many different devices, if the patch propagation is not synced, so for example, if Intel patch something but Digi don't, even in the future, then anyone can just reverse engineer the patch and they get free vulnerabilities in Digi, HP, APC, Cisco, Aruba, et cetera, et cetera. So it's like patch gapping. It's like, you know, when there's a one day and it takes 3 or 4 days until the patch is propagated to all of the devices. But with this embedded IoT supply chain, you can get a few years of free vulnerabilities just by reverse engineering patches. So this is a really problematic issue. To finalize, we did a complex reverse engineering process. Some of the vulnerabilities could only be found in forks, like the DNS vulnerabilities that could not be found in Intel. Supply chain definitely poses challenges for security. And there is a lot we don't know about how proprietary software update works. We couldn't get down to the bottom of who updates, when they update, how much it costs to update, etc. Thank you very much. We've got a few short, we've got a few short minutes for questions if anyone has any.